am really honored to be invited to this beautiful place and share some of my thoughts with you. As you heard, I am basically a heart specialist, a cardiologist who has been a teacher for the last 30 years. I have trained very large number of cardiologists all over the world, including in England. I was seeing there are about 10 of them who are my students who are doing extremely well here. As a cardiologist, I have been interested in alternative systems, and that's where I came across Preksha meditation. It's one of the best systems of yoga. And as doctors, you see, we will not be satisfied unless there is scientific evidence for that. You know, this is an age of science, and everybody wants to be convinced. So we did a research work on Preksha meditation for reversal of heart disease. It was, we took patients who had heart blockages, and we showed after about a year that Preksha meditation is extremely powerful, that even patients with three arteries blocked, the reversal can start occurring, and they can avoid bypass and all. Since that time, we have now more than 80,000 patients who we have been able to save them from bypass or angioplasty. It's so powerful. We have been interested in several other research projects also. And the largest is going to be an Indo-UK project, which is going to start next month. It has already been sanctioned by London School, with London School of Public Health and Imperial College and 16 hospitals in India. And already Swami Dharmananji and ourselves have given them a capsule of Preksha meditation, which will be tried in these patients of heart disease. So this is going to be the largest ever study done, 16 hospitals in India, 4 in England. And I think if the results are positive, this will be the strongest evidence for that, that Preksha meditation is as good. This is what we are doing for cardiac rehabilitation. It is as good as costly treatment that we do for heart disease and so on and so forth. So I am going to talk about today, about health. Of course, my stress will be still on the heart. How Preksha meditation can help in... you can change it. I must define what health is first, because you see, everybody is concerned about health these days, and yoga, which started initially in our country about 6,000 years earlier, it was not for maintaining health, because everybody was healthy. It was a type of union of the mind with the soul, and your soul with the higher soul. So that was the idea, and that's why initially when yoga started, it was being done by those people who wanted to attain become Paramatma, as you heard, from Atma to Paramatma. That's why they were doing in the caves or tops of the hills, etc., and needed tremendous concentration, etc. But last 30, 40 years, yoga has become important for maintenance of proper health, because health of individuals has really gone bad. And therefore, yoga is being used all over the world now for maintaining health. In the United States, you might be knowing 70 million people are doing yoga every day, 7 crore people. Even in England, it's very, very popular. And as I said, even Imperial College and London School of Hygiene and Public Health, they are interested. They are interested in doing research. Many of the people I met there, they are doing yoga and they believe in it. So what is health? Health is not mere absence of disease or infirmary. Because many people think that if the disease is not there, they are healthy. No, that's not true. It's a state. This is a WHO definition of physical, mental, social and spiritual well-being. So this is important. Unless you are mentally healthy, unless you are socially healthy, unless you are spiritually healthy, you are not healthy. You may be not having a disease. I do a preventive checkup in Sir Gangaram Hospital, and many people say, "Doctor, I am absolutely healthy, because you look at my treadmill test, my cholesterol is fine, I am not overweight, my sugar is all right." I say, "No, you are not healthy at all, because my psychologist says that you have a lot of anger. You have all these bad emotions. Mentally, you are unhealthy. So you are most unhealthy person. Physically, you are healthy. But you have to be mentally and spiritually, of course. Most people don't know what spirit is. What is to be spiritually healthy and all that. We will talk about that. Shramaniji, of course, has told you. Now, there are lots of challenges of health, especially for India. This is a slide from India. Longevity of life has increased for Indians. Many of you might know that in 1947, when India became independent, the average age, the mean age was only 32 years. Not that people did not live till old age, people did live 70, 80, 90, 100 years also. But because infant mortality was very high, and therefore the average age was 32, now it has become more than 65 years. That's extremely good, and this is because infant mortality and many communicable diseases have been controlled. But simultaneously what has happened is there has been rapid urbanization, industrialization, globalization, and this has made lifestyle unhealthy. People are on the rush all the time, it's called rat race. And because of this unhealthy lifestyle, there are huge epidemics of diseases which are rapidly increasing. The leading is cardiovascular disease or the heart disease. And I will show you that Indians in England have the highest heart disease as compared to any immigrants and all. So these cardiovascular diseases, diabetes and hypertension, and even cancer, they are rapidly, these are really epidemics now. In India, of course, cardiovascular disease is a real big epidemic because it kills as many as 25 lakhs, 2.5 million Indians die of heart disease. That means 5 people are dying every minute. I call it a jumbo crashing every 90 minutes, carrying about 400 people. And this disease is increasing rapidly. And this is true of Indians anywhere in the world, including in this country. And similarly, diabetes, we are the diabetic capital. Indians have the highest diabetes in the world, and this is all unhealthy. The cost of managing these diseases is extremely high. It was calculated by WHO that India spent about $230 billion in the last 10 years in looking after these diseases of diabetes, heart disease, and stroke. So these are real big challenges. So what is the healthy lifestyle? What are the adverse effects of modern lifestyle? The diet has become very unhealthy. You all know these fast food chains, not only they are here, they are everywhere in India. So India has more McDonald's than I think England has. It is so rapidly increased. There is no store which opens without a McDonald's or Pizza Hut and all. And these diets are very rich in fat. So the diet has become very rich in fat. And that has caused several diseases, including obesity, heart disease and all. And especially the bad type of fat is being used in India. People use this hydrogenated oil. Hydrogenated oils are trans fats. And that's a poison for the heart. It is as bad as smoking cigarettes. So I think we are not even aware that most of these fast food chains are using these trans fats, including these big like McDonald's and Pizza Hut and all. It's only 2 states in the United States, New York and California, they have banned trans fats. And therefore, the Pizza Hut and McDonald's have changed their menu. I wish the whole world does like that. We are trying to do it in India also, but very difficult. Too much of fat causes obesity. It causes heart disease. And Indians are very fond of making fried things and all, samosas and all that. I think samosa started in this country. It is the way we cook it is unhealthy. There are many patients of mine who make a healthy. We can make it in the microwave and all, they can put it in the vegetables, etc. But the way we make it, especially in India, they repeatedly, the halwais and the sweet sellers, they use the same oil again and again. And using the same oil again and again makes it very high in trans fats and also reduces all the good things. So it causes obesity. Obesity is the biggest problem in the world now. For example, even in the United Kingdom, the data is that 50% of the English people are going to be obese. And similarly, in whole of Europe and whole of America, India is also catching up. And too much of salt causes hypertension. The commonest disease in the world is high blood pressure and low in fiber. We are not taking fruits and vegetables. And in India, unfortunately, many people are taking non-vegetarian. Fiber is found only in vegetarian stuff. So diet has become unhealthy, you will all agree. What our parents or grandparents used to eat, we are not eating that. We have completely changed because of this eating outside. Many people, even in England or America, they don't even cook inside the house. They're so busy in their work. And eating outside really has all this bad food. It's responsible for so many diseases. We will come to that, plus including cancer. The second is mental stress is increasing. There's hardly anybody who's free of mental stress. Anybody who has no mental stress? I went to America and nobody raised the hands. I want to know that. They said, you're all well off. Some of them were, but it's mental stress. This is the biggest problem in the world now, because it not only keeps you unhappy, it keeps the family unhappy, it keeps the society unhappy, and it keeps the whole world unhappy. This is the biggest enemy. And it causes so many diseases, I'll talk about them, including heart disease. Now it's been considered as one of the major culprits for causing heart disease. So mental stress not only keeps you unhappy, but also can kill you with so many diseases and so on and so forth. And there is no method that the Western medicine or the medicine that allopathic medicine that I have been taught for so many years could control mental stress. We had psychiatrists, we had some tablets, we'll give you alprazolam or something like that. And but this is not the treatment. That's why now the yoga, preksha meditation is one of the best systems in the world. And that is why it's becoming popular all over the world. The reason is because people want to live a happy, stress-free life, isn't it? That's the ultimate aim of life. Everybody wants to be happy. We are working to be happy. We are earning money to be happy. We are owning a car or a house to be happy. Happiness is the ultimate aim of life. And we are looking for happiness outside. It's right inside us. As Chandraji has told you many times, we are looking outside. Outside happiness is always followed by unhappiness. You have a big car today, you're very happy. The next day it has a big accident, you're unhappy. You have a big house, you're happy. The moment it has a fire, you are unhappy. So outside happiness will never make you happy. It will make you unhappy most of the time. So look for the happiness which is inside us, and that can be done only in meditation. That's why yoga meditation is becoming popular all over the world, and preksha meditation is one of the simplest methods. When I was doing my research, I tried to look for all the systems, and I found that preksha meditation, which is being done in daily adhyatmic sadhana, was the easiest, and since that time we are using it for so many research projects, and we have an Indo-UK project, I told you, and we will be including this preksha meditation, and if the results come out positive, it will be the biggest evidence for preksha meditation. Now, as a result of this unhealthy lifestyle, we are having these epidemics of these diseases, very dangerous diseases. Hypertension is the commonest disease in the world. Every third person, adult person in this world has this high blood pressure. How many of you have high blood pressure? More than 140 by 90, or you are taking medicines for that. Yeah, rather healthy group, because you have only 20%. Normally it is more than 30%. But many of us have pre-hypertension. You see, blood pressure is more than 120 to 139. That's also pre. You have a likely to develop this blood pressure. Very dangerous disease. WHO has, this year it is called as a hypertension year. 10 years back it was also called hypertension, the silent killer. So it is being attracted by WHO also, because it is a disease, unfortunately, which does not cause any symptoms. In India and throughout the world, most of the people are not aware that they have hypertension. Actually, it was said in the European countries, only 50% know. And though, even if you know it's blood pressure, they don't get treatment for this. Only 50% of them get treated. And those who get treated, 50% of them get properly treated. So it's a very bad disease, because people are not having any symptoms, they don't get a treatment even if they know about it. In India, the situation is much worse. One of the studies recently has shown only 25% of people are aware that they have blood pressure. This means they never get their blood pressure. All of you are aware of your blood pressure or not? Yes or no?
No.
Yes. Okay, good. If you are not, please go and get a checkup. So the instruments are available. So, this, because this does not cause any disease. And if you do not take care of this disease, it will cause so many serious, like strokes, very common in the elderly, one of the leading causes of death. People get paralysis on one side, when, especially after the 50 years, 60 years, and this is the cause. It is the commonest cause for heart attacks. It's the commonest cause for kidney disease and eye disease and so on. So please know that this is one of the dangerous diseases, and this is again caused by this unhealthy lifestyle. Too much of salt, too much of fried things, lack of exercise, stress and all that. The second is the coronary heart disease, about which I will talk in details. This is a disease which causes angina and heart attack, and it can be fatal also. Heart attacks can be fatal in 30% immediately. So this is a disease in which deposition of cholesterol starts occurring in the coronary arteries and gradually increases. This disease doesn't start at the age of 50 years. Last week I saw a patient, he had a heart attack. He says, "Doctor, I was so healthy. Suddenly it has occurred." I don't know. I said, "It has not occurred suddenly. It has taken 40 years for it to develop. It starts from the age of 10 years actually, or even 8 years. The small deposits of cholesterol start depositing, and when the blockage is more than 70%, we get angina, pain on walking, or we get heart attack that can cause, that can be fatal also. So it is a disease which is very dangerous, again related to all unhealthy lifestyles. Diabetes mellitus, all of you know, many of you are diabetics. How many of you are diabetics? I heard there are quite a few. It's very high in Indians who are settled in India. It's very, very common. In India, it's about 4 crore, 40 million people are suffering from this disease, and it's going to increase 300% in the next 20 years. There will be 12 crore people suffering from this disease. Because this is not a disease of the sugar. We call it, it is a heart disease actually. Because people die of heart attack, they don't die of sugar. So it's a very dangerous disease, it is called heart attack equivalent. Very, very common in Indians because we are taking so-called refined carbohydrates. We should never take this refined carbohydrates. This has been discovered about 60, 70 years back. For example, we take a lot of sugar. Sugar was invented only 100 years or 80 years back, something like that. Before that, it used to be jaggery. Jaggery is a complex carbohydrate. Similarly, that white bread has come into our breakfast for the last 50, 60 years. White bread is a refined wheat. So never use a refined wheat. You should use the whole wheat. Similarly, rice has been refined. A very recent study from Thailand has shown that this basmati rice or refined rice, polished rice, can cause diabetes. But if you take brown rice, which is easily available, I'm sure most of you are health conscious, you take brown rice. So never take refined rice. And the fourth thing which has been refined is the oil. You should not take any refined oil. Refined means spoiled oil. And one should take what is known as cold compressed and all that. And two oils are available. One is the mustard oil, which I will tell you is the best. Of course, you have, I was seeing the family I'm staying, they are using rapeseed oil. Rapeseed oil is equally good. Rapeseed and mustard are safe. They are highest in omega-3. But it should preferably not refined. Only mustard oil is available, non-refined, and similarly, olive oil is available, which is called extra virgin. Yes? Pardon? Coconut oil is bad because it is very high saturated fat. Ideal oil is one which should have very small amount of saturated fats. It should have less than 10%. Many oils have like this. It should have very high monosaturated fats and it should have highest omega-3. So for this, only two oils fill it. One is rapeseed that you're using and the other is mustard oil. Even olive oil is 20 times inferior to rapeseed oil. Some of you might be using olive oil, which is advertised. But remember, olive oil does not have omega-3. So it is not equivalent to mustard oil, or it is not equivalent to even rapeseed oil which you are using. Rapeseed is canola. You get canola here? Canola is available everywhere. I was not seeing it here. Canola is a rapeseed oil made in Canada and all that. But you get mustard oil here also. And then, of course, you get a cerebrovascular disease, which is related to hypertension. This is strokes, etc. Obesity, I was telling you, half of the Europe is going to be obese in the next 20 years. That's what the predictions are. It's a very dangerous disease because people don't consider it a disease. The other day, I was walking in my garden and a lady there was walking with with her son who was obese. So I said, "Why is your son sick?" She said, "He's very healthy. Why do you call him sick?" I said, "He's overweight. Overweight is the greatest sickness." We don't agree that this is a disease first. This is the most dangerous disease because we don't accept it's a disease. We think it's a sign of healthiness. So this is a disease which can cause all these things. It can cause heart disease, it can cause diabetes, and so many other things. Sleep apnea disease coming, joint pains, and so on. So this is a very dangerous disease, and this is increasing. Indians have one type of obesity. They may not be overweight, but they are obese in the abdomen, and the waist size is very high. So if your waist size, if you are a male, it is more than 36 inches, 90 centimeters, you are suffering from this central obesity. And in ladies, if it is more than 32 inches, you are suffering from this disease. And you will be surprised, 80% of the Indians have this disease called central obesity, metabolic syndrome, that is associated with, that's a very high risk factor for diabetes and high blood pressure and heart disease. So please remember that, keep your waist size in control, that can be done by exercise. And then psychoneurotic diseases, very, very common, anxiety, depression, and so many other diseases which can be caused because of stress. And even cancer, 40% of the cancer is related to the diet that we take, people who take non-vegetarian. So healthy lifestyle is very simple. It should consist of healthy diet, which consists of nothing but low-fat diet. Use minimal amount of oil, use a good oil, either mustard oil or rapeseed oil. Take lots of fruits and vegetables. One should take 4 or 5 helpings of fruits and vegetables. Even diabetics can take 3 helpings of fruits because they are complex carbohydrates. And you should take whole grains, don't take anything refined. Use less of salt and sugar. So this is the crux of a healthy diet. It's so simple. It's preferable to be vegetarian because vegetarians have less heart disease, they have low cholesterol, they have less cancer. And a lot of data is available that one should be. And now so many papers have come that red meat especially that one takes can cause several diseases and can shorten the life also. So please remember, this non-vegetarian is not meant for us. We have been taking it, but it's good to be vegetarian because to avoid all these diseases. The second is regular exercise. We must do brisk walking for half an hour, any dynamic exercise. We can do treadmill, jogging. I know the weather is not very good here for walking outside. In India, it's of course very good. But still, most of the people don't do exercise. I was in the United States a couple of years back and I said, you all do exercise, why don't you do exercise? Only 10% do it. They don't know the reason. I said, the reason is very simple. You are slaves of your own mind. Because many of us get up in the morning and to go for a walk. Then the mind says, don't go today. Don't you know you had a late night? Today it's snowing today. Don't go today. So we accept that. Who is telling that? It's the mind. And this is exactly, if we are slaves of our mind, we will not be able to do. We found that people who are doing preksha meditation, they become master of their mind. And for knowing who you are, you have to know you are the consciousness, you are the Atma. And that can be only realized, cannot be shown, unfortunately. No scientific data. But you can really realize it. In preksha meditation, anytime meditation, when we say close your eyes and watch your breath. Now who is watching the breath? The eyes are closed, it is your consciousness. So you get a communication with your consciousness, and that's why preksha meditation, as you know, Acharya Tulsi and Acharya Mahaprajna has said, that you should, knowing self through self. So exactly, this is what it is. So if you are able to do exercise, and that is by controlling your mind, we found that people are doing preksha meditation, 80% people are doing it regularly, those who are not doing preksha meditation, only 20% do, because the same excuse. Similar, the diet control also. The mind says, you can have an ice cream today, tomorrow you won't have it. So the tomorrow never comes actually. So it's very good to follow the healthy lifestyle to keep your mind strong, because the all problems are starting from the mind. That's why the doctors are getting interested into the modern medicine, very interested, because the origin of the disease is the mind. The mind tells us smoking is not going to harm you. Everybody knows it's bad. The mind tells us exercises you should not do. You know it's good for you, but still you don't know. The mind tells you that you can take a little food today, and you know it's bad. So please control your mind, and this is the, I think, the maximum use of preksha meditation. So it's very simple. This is our grandparents told us the same thing. The simple living and high thinking. This is hari vari kari. You should take a healthy diet, do regular exercise, avoid stress. That's the most difficult part, but the easiest to do if you are following preksha meditation. Should not take tobacco, and you should have pollution-free environment. Now, where does preksha meditation, that's my main talk, where does preksha meditation fit in the healthy lifestyle? I will like to define it in my own terms. I know experts are here. Shramling is here, and you know quite a bit of it. But this is what I would like to say in very simple terms. Preksha means perception, and meditation means dhyana. It means concentration. It's a mean of a very simple method of concentrating on perception. And it includes various disciplines, which we include in our research study, Cryosurg is like shavasana. It's a method of relaxation by auto-sedation. A lot of data on this. It can lower blood pressure, it can cause relaxation. EEG have been done during this and so on. Just a simple thing like cryosurg, which you can do even before sleeping. It is a method of relaxation. It is also called as yog nidra. People who have insomnia, they can also sleep well if they... I have seen many patients who are not able to sleep. I said, do cryosurg. It's called yog nidra. They are able to sleep if they are able to do properly. Because it's a method of relaxation by auto-sedation. A lot of scientific data is there. The second is the pranayama. Most of us do not know how to breathe properly. When I was doing my research study, I found 99% of the people were breathing wrongly. Because when we breathe in, abdomen should come out. And when we breathe out, it should go in. So this is called abdominal breathing or diaphragmatic breathing. It has been shown scientifically, if you use the diaphragm, then the vital capacity, the air which goes in is 30% more. So we are not breathing rightly. So my patient said, doctor, we are breathing wrongly for 50 years. And I'm not surprised because I've got a heart disease. Because when we breathe in, I must tell you again, abdomen should come out. And this is what is taught. And when we breathe out, it should go in. So that is using diaphragm. Reverse happens, you can see yourself. So those of you, of course, who are doing it, they will know that. And there are various types of pranayama, alternate nose, nadi shodhan. It's not necessary to all of them, but a simple one, anulom vilom or nadi shodhan is good enough for you. Then there are health rejuvenating exercises. These are very important, especially if you start meditation, yoga at an elderly age, which most of our heart patients were. These are stretching exercises with breathing, so that our joints remain flexible. Starting, many of you must be knowing this, starting with the neck, the shoulders, and the spine, and the so on. So these are stretching exercises that are very, very important. Actually, anybody, we were looking for a method that day one, a person can say he can do yoga. When I was starting my project on yoga, when I asked my patients, will you do yoga? Doctor, very difficult. Those asanas are very complicated. We can't even sit on the floor. How can we do yoga? So I was looking for a method and I found that this Preksha meditation is the easiest. People were standing and they had to just take deep breaths. They had to just move their neck. And they said, yes, we can do yoga from day one. And half of the people could not sit on the floor. Doesn't matter at all. They were sitting on the chair and doing it. So we have started so-called sessions of Preksha meditation sitting on the chair. So with a straight spine. So you can do that, actually. This is the beauty of yoga. It can be done by anybody at any age and irrespective of physical condition. Even if you can't sit, you can do it lying down. There's no problem with it. So, it is very simple. Health rejuvenating exercises are important because all of us have this osteoarthritis and we want to keep the body flexible. And if the body is not flexible, if you can't sit still, we cannot do meditation. And for sitting still, we should have no pains, etc. And that's where the stretching exercises help us quite a bit. A few asanas. We tell surely to do simple ones, but that's not necessary. As the age advances, you may not be able to do many asanas, but we try to ask them to do as many asanas as they can do. And then finally, this is the most important, contemplation or anupreksha. I repeated positive thought. We told them that your arteries are blocked, your right artery is blocked 70%. Now imagine it's opening up, and so on and so forth. And this is how when you repeatedly think positively, there is some effect. Some of them were able to open, not completely, maybe slightly 5% or so. At least it doesn't progress further. And this has been used in Preksha meditation for getting all the negative emotions removed, the fear, etc., and so on. And lots of things can be achieved by this content. This is something unique, which is not found in most of the parts of yoga. And this is meditation, the scientific aspect. Because I'm a scientist, I was interested to see that there should be scientific evidence. And there are a lot of, this is called functional MRI imaging. You must be MRI, all of you are aware, magnetic resonance imaging of the brain, etc. has been done. But this is functional. It tells us what is happening. So you can see that this is during a meditation. It's not Preksha meditation, but similar data is available in many types of. When a person is doing meditation, you see on the right side, then those areas are activity where peace and tranquility is there. Actually, we use only 10% of the brain. We use the part of the brain where anger and ego, etc. lie. We never use the part of the brain where happiness and peace is there. And this has been shown. repeatedly, thousands of trials are available by any type of meditation. You can get it, this is transcendental meditation, you can see Vipassana, you can see the Buddhist system, all of them, including Preksha, those areas are activated where happiness and peace is there and concentration is there. We are not able to concentrate because the mind, and these are, and similarly, those areas the activity becomes less where ego is there, where jealousy is there, where enmity is there. So this has been clearly shown that during meditation, lots of things are happening in our mind, which can be documented here. In addition, of course, the whole biochemistry of the body is changing. There are some bad chemicals which are reduced. For example, these are catecholamines, cortisol is reduced, and good chemicals called antioxidants. Endorphins are there. It's called happy hormone. It keeps you happiness. It also melatonin, which gives you sleep, etc. So, and the whole nervous system changes. For example, we have a dominance of the parasympathetic blood. Heart rate comes down. So, a lot of scientific data is there that meditation is extremely useful, and physiologically, it changes our whole biochemistry, changes the nervous system, changes the endocrine system, and also changes the brain activity, as you see here. Now, what are the benefits of meditation? These are all scientific data is available, and huge number of, if you see the internet, you will find that it is extremely beneficial for controlling stress. There are more than 70 stress management techniques. All of them use meditation. And there have been at least five theses written on Preksha meditation also. Some of them, I have also seen that, that extremely good for stress management technique. It also controls anxiety and depression. There are several studies to show that in depression, which is a very, very common disease, meditation is as good as some of these drugs without any side effect. All the drugs have side effects. People become sleepy and so on and so forth. So, extremely useful for these psychoneurotic diseases like anxiety, depression, which are very, very common. There's hardly anybody who does not get depression, hardly anybody who does not get anxious and all that. With this, you can remove that and several other things of stress. It has been shown extremely useful for controlling of blood pressure. And there are more than 1,000 studies, you'll be surprised, using different type of meditation. There are several in Preksha meditation also. We have done two of these studies, which are published also. And they show that the blood pressure can be reduced. Not very dramatically, but at least 4 or 5 millimeters. So people who have mild hypertension, means less than 160 by 100, or so-called pre-hypertension, or blood pressure is fluctuating, sometimes very high, sometimes low. We use this and it's been found to be extremely useful. Just a small decrease of blood pressure, if you, the whole population can decrease the blood pressure by 2 millimeters diastolic, it will be much better than treating all patients of hypertension, and it will cut down strokes by more than 50%. So if people are doing meditation, the heart disease and strokes will come down markedly, even if the blood pressure changes by 2 or 3 millimeters. And it does. All studies of meditation, there's a lot of data on transcendental meditation, there's a lot of data on this Buddhist system, mindfulness meditation, and Preksha meditation, several other transcendental meditation especially have been shown to reduce blood pressure. So, those of you who are taking drugs can stop it. Many of my patients have stopped drugs if they have mild hypertension. Even if they are having severe hypertension, the amount of medicines needed are reduced. Reversal of heart disease, I'll talk about that. We have done studies to show that even blockage in the arteries could be reduced. And I'm not the only one. Studies from other places also, like Dean Ornish has shown from the United States. And recently a study from India has shown by Rajyoga meditation, which Brahm Kumaris follow. They have gained similar results. So in other words, any type of meditation or yoga you use, if you use it properly, the end result is the same. Because ultimately it tranquilizes the mind, and so reversal of heart disease is a very, very important thing which has been shown in several studies and all. And recently we will show you, we have done one more study which has just been getting to be published now. It can control diabetes and high cholesterol and obesity. A lot of, again, studies are available. I'm not going to details. We have also shown that cholesterol reduces by as much as 21%. This is surprising. how can yoga reduce cholesterol? But there are studies. One of the studies recently has come in our Indian Heart Journal, leading study that yoga can reduce cholesterol, obesity, of course, and diabetes. A lot of data on diabetes also. Similarly, other psychoneurotic diseases like bronchial asthma, migraine. Migraine is a very bad disease because it occurs on the half side of the head, nausea, vomiting. Very difficult to treat. Doctors have very little medicines. And we have seen that there are several studies available that meditation could improve this severe headache which comes on one side. Of course, the commonest cause of headache is anyhow anxiety. So every second individual on this planet has some headache or the other. And the reason is not hypertension. Hypertension never causes high blood pressure unless very, very high, which is very rare. So it is caused by anxiety. So headache can be reduced. It can even control many gastrointestinal disease like irritable bowel, sometimes constipation. And this data is available from All India Institute of Medical Sciences. Our colleagues have shown that it can. And it's very good for de-addiction. People who are chronic smokers or alcoholics, this can stop breaksha meditation. Many of my patients, I have now experienced 80,000, they used to smoke, they said it's not possible. The moment it is a residential course, the moment they came to Adhyatmik Sandhakya, I asked them, how did you stop it? He says, it never came our mind to smoke. We were so busy, the whole, I think vibrations, everything changes once you start doing this thing. And the most important thing is better compliance with lifestyle. As I said, most of us know exercise is good, but we don't do because we don't have control of our mind. The mind says, don't go for a walk today, it's snowing, you had a late night, some excuse or the other. And so you don't do it. And this is what we found, that exercise and diet is better followed with this. So I will talk about preventive meditation for reversal of heart disease. This is our original work which has been published also. And this is the work which is under sort of publication in one of the very top American journals. This was done only last year from Gangaram Hospital. We have a preksha meditation, we call it a yoga lifestyle, preksha meditation lifestyle clinic. I like to call yoga or preksha meditation as type of lifestyle because it's not only doing meditation, you have to control your diet, you have to do exercise and stop smoking. So this is a paper we recently presented. This is in Bombay. This is under publication. This is early atherosclerosis. You know, this disease, as I said, starts from early childhood and from the age of 10 years, and we are not even aware of it. One of the methods of finding out early blockages is to doing a Doppler or an echocardiogram of the carotid artery, and you can see thickening of this. So we have taken 100 adult patients who were absolutely asymptomatic. This is from my executive checkup area. And these people were healthy, but they had central obesity. Their waist size, their metabolic syndrome as we call it. So their waist was more, and they said they are healthy otherwise. And we found that they had these blockages starting to appear. They were not aware they were healthy otherwise. It was only 5% and thickening of the arteries. And so we took 50% conventional and 50 were given preksha meditation for 1 year. And the preksha meditation, as I said, included all those things, including diet and stopping of. And it was the meditation was practiced for 1 hour daily and consisted of health rejuvenating exercises, pranayama, relaxation, and preksha meditation. And we followed for 1 year, and we had a very good compliance, about 77%. And this is what we found at 1 year. This is very remarkable. This is for the first time ever it has been shown that preksha meditation can reduce the early blockages. You see, this is called carotid intimal thickness. Statistically significant, 0.4, and the control will decrease. See, this means the blockages of the arteries, which are very, very slight, and this, as I said, is being published in one of the very prestigious journals. I've been told it's under print now. It's a journal of yoga and physical therapy. It's one of the leading American journals which have accepted this, because for the first time we have shown that if you do preksha meditation at an early stage, the disease will not occur. In addition, you can see these are a lot of data here, but I would like to show you that people who were doing preksha meditation, that is the red ones, you can see that they had a better control of cholesterol, the better control of the LDL, even their weight came down much more, the waist size also improved, and all those blood pressures came down much more. So preeksha meditation in addition to control, one has to do, you see, randomized control studies. Only then it becomes. We know that for years we have been told by these yoga therapists that this is good because 100 patients came and they improved. But that doesn't make it scientific. Scientific, you have to have a control. And this is why we made it like that. And you see here that, this is markedly improved. So this is where we will conclude that the preeksha meditation can significantly reduce early blockages, early atherosclerosis, as assessed by this echocardiography of the carotid artery. It has beneficial effects on the total weight. The waist circumference also reduced much more, and the blood pressure and the cholesterol as compared. Of course, we need large study, but this is already one of the studies which is quoted all over. And this was the first study we did somewhere in 1906, and this is how I got introduced to preeksha meditation. This was a study, coronary atherosclerosis, what's the potential of preeksha meditation lifestyle intervention. And I remember starting in 1904, and I was fortunate to have the blessings of Acharya Tulsi and Acharya Mahapragya, who were both there in Chaturmas in Delhi, and I wanted to start a project, so I said I'm going to start it. And I was encouraged. I think how scientific these our spiritual masters are. They told me, "Doctor, we think we are helping the patients. You will tell us the truth." They wanted to do this study themselves, and this is the first study ever done to show that preeksha meditation can really. So I think you are all very blessed. Shami ji is here. I was blessed by all the masters and who have been showering blessings to me. The blessings matter quite a lot. So this was the first study that we did. It was a user-friendly and first study in which more than 70% of blockages, there were people who had two or three arteries blocked. Very courageous study to do, because it can be done in India. Before that, Dean Ornish had done a study in which the blockage was only 30%. He couldn't do more, 70%. And we also gave them a practical reversal diet. And this is, I will not bother you with that, but all of them had more than 70% blockages. And this was our inclusion criteria. We only took 42 patients. And this was our program of preeksha meditation. We asked them to control the risk factors. If they were smokers, they should stop smoking. And other risk factors, we asked them to control. We gave them a diet, because we believe that diet is a part of yoga. Yoga is not a few postures or asanas, but it's a complete lifestyle in which physically, mentally, emotionally, spiritually to be healthy. This means diet is a part of it. And similarly, doing exercise is a part of it. So we gave them a diet which was vegetarian and low in fat and lots of fruits and vegetables. And these are the preeksha meditation method. I'm sure all of you are aware of it. How many of you are doing a preeksha meditation? There's very few. I think all of you can do it. It's very simple. Shambhiji is here and all. We have made some of these CDs, etc. I tell my patients who have never done it, go to Adhyatmik Kendra just for 2 hours, learn a little. Then take the CD and you can do it at home. Even my nephew, who is with whom I am staying, he took the CD, and I told, I saw that my niece is doing it every day. You know, seeing that CD makes a lot of difference. I think it's not difficult. It's the easiest thing to do. As I said, even if patients of the 70 years, 80 years can do with heart disease, all of you can do it. The only thing is you need a little strong mind. Yes, first month, 2 months, you will have to struggle. But if you can overcome that period, then you become addicted. I'm telling you, I'm staying in a colony called New Rajendra, one of the very posh colonies of New Delhi. And I started that meditation in the park itself, because some of I couldn't go to that Adhyatmik Sadhak. It was far away, about 20 kilometers away. So we started there with 2 people. Now we have 70 people who are doing it every day, 6 to 7. Whether it's cold, whether it's raining, everybody comes there. Because the day they miss, they think they are sick. I said, "Why do you come?" They said, "If we don't do it, we feel we are sick." So this should be the attitude. And this will happen surely. There is a morning walkers club. You get addicted to good things like even exercise. I go to Lodhi Gardens, and there are people above the age of 70. They say only 2 reasons why a person will miss. Either he's no more, he's dead, or he's seriously sick. So they always go to that person's house and find out. And one of these 2 things is there. So this is what this is going to happen. And this is not only theory, I'm telling you, practice. Because with 2 people, now you have 70 people in a park. People were a little shy that how will we do in an open park this yoga and all. This is the most...
This, the,
This is in New Rajendra Nagar, let's say. Any colony, you can do it any colony. You can do it in parks here also. I go to that, there's a park near the place, Hounslow West, I'm going there. I see two or three people doing some yoga and all that thing. But you could do it. You see, of course, the weather is not very good, I'll agree. But wherever the weather is not good, you can do by rotation in somebody's house. I have seen in Canada, where the weather is equally bad and all that, in the basement of many houses, they do it alternate days, once a week or sometimes every day. A group has to be there of 10, 12. Because it's always good to do in a group rather than doing it alone. Because alone, you always like to cut short. Nobody's watching. So it's always, I think, it's a good thing to do. So you can do all that. There's no problem about it. I'm telling you some of these practical things. And this is the diet we gave to these people. This was very low in fat. We allowed them only one or two spoons of oil. And that also we gave them the mustard oil. Mustard oil is one of the best oil, as I told you, like the rapeseed. Mustard oil is like rapeseed oil, has very high omega-3. And there's a study done from India, 8 hospitals where it has been published, that people who use mustard oil in India, they have 70% less heart attacks. This is published in one of the American Journal of Clinical Nutrition. It came even in Times of India several years back. So there is objective data, and the reason is very simple, because it has omega-3, which is very protective. You all take these flax seeds, etc., etc. So all these things are coming in mustard oil. Mustard seeds, we are trying to now bring it out. They're much cheaper than flax seeds, and hopefully within a year or so, one of those commercial people will start coming out with these mustard seeds. Rice seeds you use, many of you, rice also same as omega-3. These are all omega-3. Unfortunately, flax seeds are most popular because they are commercially viable. They are trying to make it. It will be cheaper soon. So this has been shown that and lots of fruits and high fiber, maybe the 50 gram of fiber, Indians can take it through the vegetarian diet. And there are certain things which reduce cholesterol, like Bengal gram, kala chana, you know that. In chapatis, we said you have this kala chana atta, 10%. Soya has been shown to reduce, so soya atta also inside. So in chapati, and they can take this soya in many ways. You can take it as nutrient nuggets and so on. Oats have been shown to reduce xylem husk, that is isabgol, which we take. It isabgol reduces cholesterol. We have shown, and we ask them to take 1.5 teaspoonful of isabgol before lunch and dinner. It reduces cholesterol by 10% or so.
Can you take every
day? Twice a day, every day. It's like taking, you see, fruits and vegetables. After all, what is xylem husk? It's a pure fiber. We are not able to take 5 kilos of vegetables and this thing. It takes care of constipation. It is used for constipation, I know that. But it is also used for reducing cholesterol. It is a high fiber. It also prevents cancer. 40% of the cancer is related to this fiber. It also reduces weight. Because, you see, when you take isabgol before meals, it gives you a sense of fullness. And finally, it also is helpful in diabetes, because whatever you take, it becomes like a sponge and is excreted. Even the oil is absorbed there, and that's why you take a lot of water with this. It is it's extremely useful. I'm told it's very popular here also.
So you take
it before meals? Only or?
Pardon?
Can we take, should we take a spongy or
just
in water?
No, you can take either raw and take water with them. A lot of water has to be taken.
No, but some, when we put in the water, if we keep for 2-3 minutes, it becomes spongy.
It doesn't become spongy. If you take, you know, purified isabgol is available in many forms. In India, it's available as xylem husk, as Naturalax, as even Dabur has something, Nature Cure. It dissolves very well. They have purified it, so it becomes like orange juice. So I ask my patients to take that. Softobac, Fibril, you have, I think, Dabur Nature Cure or something like that, it dissolves. But even if it doesn't dissolve, take it 1.5 teaspoonful and take at least a large glass of water. Because it becomes like a sponge. And when you take anything, the sponge absorbs the sugar as well as the fat and it excretes it out.
It is known as fiber gel.
Fiber gel, yes. Fiber gel is another name. So many names are there. In United States, they call it mucomycin or something like that. So it's the same thing. Before meals. After meals is all right for constipation, but before meals if you take, then it will reduce your cholesterol. Because the philosophy is simple, it becomes like a sponge. Whatever food you take, the extra fat is absorbed by it and excreted.
About 10 hours before?
about 15-20 minutes early. We published a study. There are 6 studies available, 5 from the United States, 1 from India, that's my study, and all have given it before that, about 15 grams. Yeah. Then fruits and vegetables, extremely useful. One of the main reasons why Indians get heart disease is lack of fruits and vegetables. A big study, what's called intra-heart study, which was done by an Indian who is in Canada, Dr. Salim Yusuf, trying to find out why heart disease occurs in 52 countries, including India, China, England, Middle East countries, America, Canada. And one of the consistent things was lack of fruits and vegetables is responsible. Of course, stress was another factor, which was true in all countries. So, I think we should take fruits and vegetables, but it should be fresh fruits and vegetables. There's a study done recently from England itself. They say that these so-called fruits which are there for a long period of time, or plucked long back, they are no use at all. Because, you know, for the first time I saw this farm fresh, etc., only here. Because in India it's good, seasonal fruits are the best, because they are not. But there is some Australian apple which is available in India, which is which looks very big, and which very, very good also to look at. But it's zero food value, because it is put into the cold storage and cups after 3 months. So similarly, most of the things which come in England, you should be careful. If they come after cold storage of 6 months, even if they look good, because this is the only country, and America is the only where I saw this farm fresh. They are spraying it and keeping it in refrigeration all the time. So please find out which is relatively fresh. Whatever grows here during the season is much fresh, or whichever takes the minimum time. Because most of these fruits which are really not fresh, they have no food value at all. They may look very good and all. So please remember that. This is a study done from British Medical Journal only last month. I always say that, that's why I'm telling, don't go to these marriages, you have those imported fruits. They are useless. Because they are coming from cold storage, they're plucked long back, and they are not ripe, and then they're kept in the cold storage, and they are brought here, and so on. So this is important. Fruits and vegetables are very important. They will take care of lots of things, not only heart disease, but hypertension, even cancer. All cancer surgeons in the world say if you want to reduce cancer, take 5 helpings of fruits and vegetables, fresh fruits and vegetables. And similarly, even diabetes, they are very good. High antioxidants, of course. One should not take those pills. You see, I know multivitamin pills are very, very popular all over, but they're useless. A lot of, more than 1,000 studies, and but they should be taken, antioxidants from natural sources. For example, vitamin E is very good from nuts. People who take about 15 to 20 almonds a day, or walnuts, they're extremely good. They have vitamin E. Similarly, you take fresh fruits and vegetables, they have a lot of antioxidants. Similarly,